Good day everyone. Next we see TTL gate NAND gates. The output goes to totem pole and we will explain what a totem pole is there as well. This is what a NAND gate looks like. We see that at the inputs there are more than one input, A and B. The voltages will be applied at terminals A and B, and these are applied to emitters E1 and E2. Depending on the number of inputs, the number of emitters will also be different. So you see that the input transistor that you're using is a multi-emitter transistor. What do I mean by multi-emitter? It means that there is more than one emitter terminal for the BJT. Now we have two inputs, therefore you have two emitters. Now let me try to explain the electrical connection of emitters E1 and E2. You see that E1 and E2 are both connected to the base of transistor Q1. So both E1 and E2 are connected to the base terminal at one end. So one end is common. What about the other end? E1 and E2 are both connected via B2 and D3 to the terminal ground. So both of them are connected to the same terminal ground. You see that if B2 and D3 are identical, we can consider that E1 and E2 have a common point ground at the other point. So both the terminals of E1 and E2 are common, which means that it is something like a parallel connection. E1 and E2 are like a parallel connection. This is how we are going to consider E1 and E2 electrically. So in order to understand the working, this is how we will consider the electrical connection of E1 and E2. Let us start. Apply 0 and 1. In case of a NAND gate, I have A, B and output Y. Let us try to construct the truth table as we understand the working. And let us see whether it conforms to the original truth table of the NAND gate. You apply 0 and 1, which means it is 0 volt and VCC. When you apply 0 at one end, that is equivalent to having a short at one of the parallel connections. So at E1, you have a short or it is connected to ground. In that case, E2 would also be shorted out since they have parallel connections. So effectively, this is like a logic 0 or like a ground. Effectively, the emitter or the N-type or the emitter of the Q1 transistor emitter or the N-type terminal, N-type side of the transistor is 0 volts. What about the base of Q1? We already know that it is VCC minus VR1. We have seen it in the NOT gate, and I have explained that. So base being P-type has VCC minus VR1, which means that the base has a more positive voltage with respect to the emitter, and which means that it is forward biased. So let us mark this as forward biased junction. Okay. Once again, what about the current? The current flowing from VCC will prefer the low resistance path, which is the reverse bias junction, which is emitter base junction. Therefore, very little or no current flows into the base of Q2. So, collector base junction, no current flows. Base of Q2, no current received. Therefore, Q2 is off. If Q2 is off, it cannot source current to the base of Q4. Therefore, Q4 is also off. Meanwhile, the high voltage VCC terminal current is flowing through R2, and it endures or it encounters a block here because Q2 is off. So the current will flow, majority or almost all the current will flow into the base of Q3, turning Q3 on. Now look at the situation here. The output Y is connected to VCC through the on transistor Q3, and current flows. Okay. It is pulled up to VCC. Pulled up to VCC means it's a logic 1. What did we just get? We applied an input of 0, 1 and I got an output of 1. Consider the next case 1, 0. If A is 1 and B is 0, the same situation happens, isn't it? Because effectively it is a 0 at the input. If effectively it is a 0 at the input, this is exactly what we just saw right now, and the output would still be 1. What if I have both equal to 0, 0, 0? If the input is both 0, it still remains, the situation still holds. That means if both are 0, effectively I have a 0 at the emitter and the output would still be a 1. And finally, we come to the last case, that is 1, 1 case. Okay. The 1, 1 case, the output is expected to be a 0. Let us see if our circuit gives us a 0. Input 1-1 is applied, and you see that it is VCC at this end, and here it is VCC minus VR1. Just like in the case of NOT gate, this is a reverse bias junction because the P end is having a lower voltage than the N end. Therefore, it is reverse biased. Current will not flow through this emitter base junction. Current will prefer to flow through the collector base junction, and it will flow into the base of Q2. Meanwhile, since Q2 is on, so the current flowing into the base of Q2 turns on Q2, and therefore current will flow from VCC through Q2, and it also flows into the base of Q4. Okay, R4 is so biased such that the current flowing into the base of Q4 will be sufficient enough to turn on Q4, and therefore Q4 turns on. When Q4 is on, meanwhile, what happens at the upper end of the outermost Q3? What happened to Q3? Well, majority of the current has flown down. It prefers to flow through the lower resistance path, and it prefers to go down to the ground. Therefore, the current has flown down, and into the base of Q3, it is not sufficient. Therefore, Q3 is now what happens? What is the situation at the output? Output is connected directly to ground. Therefore, output becomes logic 0. What just happened? When A is 1 and B is 1, output Y is equal to 0. This was the final phase that we were waiting for. Let me fill it here. You see. So this is a truth table that we have constructed using the working of NAND gate. Does this conform to the original truth table of the NAND gate? Yes, because for a NAND gate, if there is a single 0 at the input, output will definitely be 1. 0 is the controlling input of NAND gate. And if all the inputs are 1, output will be 0. This is our truth table of NAND gate is, and it has conformed to the original truth table. So that is how the NAND gate works. Now let me move on to give you a better understanding of the outermost arm here. See, the outermost arm here consists of R3, Q3, B1 and Q4. This forms a totem pole pair. Do you know what a totem pole pair is? Totem pole is, actually a cultural monument or structure actually. It depicts memories and culture and dances, songs, even ancestors. A lot of information is contained in the totem pole. It's a structure that looks like this. It was used by indigenous groups. But this is not our totem pole. Our totem pole just happens to have one structure on top of another. Okay, so it just follows the same structure. It does not have the same meaning. This is like R3, this is like Q3, this is like D1, and this is like Q4. So it just follows the same structure. Now, R3, B1, Q4. R3, Q3, B1, Q4. You see, when the input is 1, 1, you know that current flows in, Q2 is on, and when Q2 is on, the voltage across collector emitter of a silicon based transistor is 0.3 volt. And when this is on, Q4 is also on. When Q4 is on, the emitter base junction, this is emitter and this is base. Emitter base junction for a silicon based transistor is 0.7 volt. So I have marked these voltages. Okay. Let me rewrite that. The voltage between collector of Q2 and emitter of Q2 is 0.3. I have marked it here. The voltage between base of Q4 and emitter of Q4 is 0.7. What is 0.3 plus 0.7? 1 volt. So the voltage at this point, between this point and this point, that is between C2 and E4, is equal to 0.3 plus 0.7, that is equal to 1 volt. Okay. Now, let me try to distribute that 1 volt, okay, into the outermost arm, that is our totem pole arm. When I try to distribute that 1 volt, I start from the bottom. I already know that Q4 is on. If Q4 is on, 0.3 volt is voltage is dropped across the collector emitter of Q4. So 0.3 voltage is taken out of the 1 volt. Okay, 1 volt at this point between these two points, okay, that is between this point and this point. 0.3 volt is already used up. What remains is, okay, what remains is 0.7 volt. 0.7 volt between the base of Q3, base of Q3, and this is collector of Q4, C4, C3. So between these two points, you have 0.7 volt. Let me try to understand how this 0.7 volt is distributed. This 0.7 volt has to be distributed between the emitter base junction of Q3 and across the diode D1. Now, if I distribute this 0.7 between these two voltages, let me write the equation like this. VBE3 plus VB1 is equal to 0.7 volt. VBE3 is the emitter base junction of Q3 and VD1 is the voltage across D1. You have only 0.7 volt left. So I can distribute this voltage in many ways. I want both of them to be on, okay? I'm going to take the counter assumption. I'm going to take the counter assumption that Q3 needs to be conducting even when Q4 is on. So if I want to do that, I have to take this case, VBE3, that means emitter base junction of Q3 has to be on or forward bias, so it needs 0.7. But then I have used up all my 0.7, therefore the other one, the voltage across D1 has to be 0, which means D1 will become off, right? But if D1 is on, current cannot flow through this arm, right? So that case cannot be used. Now, if I want to make D1 on, I have to give 0.7 to the D1 transistor because it needs 0.7 volt across the D1 transistor, silicon-based D1 transistor, to make D1 conducting. In that case, I would have nothing left across the emitter base of Q3, you see, 0. In that case also, current will not conduct, so I cannot use that case either. Now, if I try to distribute this 0.7 equally or unequally between emitter base of Q3 and PN junction D1, say 0.35 and 0.35, in that case both of them would be off. So none of these cases work, which means that I cannot distribute 0.7 in such a way that both Q3 as well as D1 will be on, which is actually required to ensure that Q3 conducts. So I'm talking about an impossible situation. What is the impossible situation? The situation that Q3 is on. So Q3 is on is impossible. So Q3 and D1 can never be on simultaneously. Therefore, the conclusion is Q3 is off. What did we start out with? Q4 is on. When Q4 is on, you see that Q3 is off. This is ensured because of the presence of D1. Okay, because of the presence of D1 only, this has happened. In conclusion, Q3 and Q4 can never be simultaneously on. Okay, and of course, it satisfies the working of the NAND gate. So that's all for the understanding of the circuit and working of the NAND gate with totem pole output. Consider one more case. Suppose at the output, instead of a totem pole, you do not have anything at the pull-up end. You only have a Q3 transistor to pull down the output. In this case, we call it an open collector output. That means the collector of Q3 is open. It is not pulled up to VCC. In such a case, a problem arises, that is, we do not have a provision to get logic 1. You see that the output can be pulled down to 0 through Q3 transistor. So output will be logic 0 when Q3 is on. Okay. What about the case where Q3 is off? When Q3 is off, I would expect that the output is a logic 1. But in that case, there is nothing to pull up Q3 to VCC. So what we do is we have to connect an external resistor to VCC and pull it up externally. This is how the open collector output works. Okay. So I hope this is clear to you guys. There is one more state, that is tri-state output. I will leave it to you as an exercise. These are the three ways in which you can take the output of a TTL gate. Any TTL output can be taken through three outputs. One is totem pole, second one is open collector output, and the third one is tri-state output. The working would be the same, just the output, how it is taken. Okay. Thank you.